so we can sense you and walk with you. Our hearts cry out and thirst for you, Lord Jesus. How we thank you. Come, be in our midst. Speak to us through your mighty word. Do you agree with me? And let it be so. Let it be so. I had thought tonight about speaking to you on a given subject, and still am inspired to head that direction. I thought about doing Chase the Rabbit, but I feel compelled that we're not supposed to chase the rabbit. Chase the Rabbit, of course, is that means that you get to set the agenda, kind of like the thing of asking questions about Scripture. We answer those, but we're not headed there. I feel like the Lord has something special in for us, and so I would ask you to say a little prayer under your breath. Lord, that guy up there, I'm supposed to hear you through him. Now, that's an awesome responsibility. If you're supposed to hear him through me, then I'm a man, and so you need to pray that, Lord, would you speak through that man to me? Would you speak through your word to me so I can receive something from you? Now, I remind you that even a donkey turned around and spoke to a guy to give him a personal word of the Lord. So if you're worried that God can't do it, think again. He has plenty of capabilities of opening your ears and mind. So with that, let's jump into the Word. I have a passage of Scripture I want to give you. Isaiah 41 and 17. When the poor and needy seek water, and there is none, and their tongue faileth for thirst, I, the Lord, will hear them. I, the God of the chosen ones, will not forsake them. I will open rivers in high places and fountains in the midst of the valleys. And I will make the wilderness a pool of water and the dry land springs of water. I have one more passage of Scripture that I want to allude to before we move on in our text, Isaiah 55 and 6. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous his thoughts. I love that, that God identifies that if we're in our thoughts, that we're walking away from him or not doing things according to his instruction, that we are unrighteous. And he's saying, seek me. Most of us don't identify ourselves necessarily out and outright with the wicked if we've been walking any time with the Lord at all, which I thank God that we choose a different path to become good and take on the nature of Jesus Christ, because Jesus is the only good thing that there is. He is the only goodness that can be within us. But I think too often we just skip right over the part about our thoughts. Our thoughts. Remember, Jesus talked about man's thoughts. He said that, you know, he was commenting about the fornication and adultery, and he said a person who even thinks it in their head has already committed that crime. And so my point is we can, although we're pursuing God in some small degree, we can have unrighteous thoughts. And so in this passage of Scripture, he says, seek the Lord while he can be found. Call upon him while he's near. And let the wicked forsake his way. So if we are doing something we know there's intentional wrong, then we need to just forsake it and stop doing it. And then the righteous man needs to change his thoughts and let him return to the Lord. So if our thoughts are not on the Lord, he's saying, return to the Lord. So if we want righteousness, it's not only a matter of stop doing something, it's a matter of start doing something. And what is that start doing? It's seeking the Lord with all of our heart, mind, soul, and body. And then it makes this statement about God, his nature, his character, his purposes, and his actions. And he will have compassion on us. And he will abundantly pardon. Our God will abundantly pardon. So if you need a pardon for ignoring him, if you need a pardon because your thoughts have wandered, you need a pardon because you know that you've done something that is wicked, he's willing to look at those things and grant the pardon based upon what? Seek the Lord while I can be found. So it takes upon the nature that our position and purpose is to seek God and call upon the name of the Lord. Now, God comes back and he makes this statement. He realizes there's a problem. The problem is not in him. The problem is not in his mind. The problem is not in his thinking. He is righteous. He is pure. He's a master engineer. He's made no mistakes. He's made no miscalculations. There's no time in heaven that God ever woke up and said, wow, I didn't know that wasn't going to happen. I'm so surprised. God has never said that he was so surprised about anything that there is. And he will not, because he knows the beginning from the end, and he inhabits all of time. So he, for our purposes, relays to us this understanding. And he just says it point blank. My thoughts are not your thoughts. So if I have studied the scripture for a while, in which I meet lots of people that do a little bit of studying in the scripture, and all of a sudden they're an authority. And I'm thinking, well, if you're an authority, you're supposed to be standing in the presence of Jesus. You're supposed to be standing hearing him. You're supposed to be standing listening to him. You're supposed to be acting like him. You're supposed to be like him. So most of the people that say that they're, or, you know, study a little bit of the scripture, and don't get me wrong, we're supposed to study scripture, we are. But I liken that to the guy that goes to work for Boeing, and he's been there for 3 months, and he walks in, hey, look, guys, y'all are just not building these planes right. Is there a problem with that? The boss will say, go back to your job on the assembly line. Why? Because he's not an engineer. Okay, suppose he goes and gets an engineer's degree, and he shows up, and 3 months later, he says, hey, guys, y'all aren't building these planes right, and I've got a different design for you. Well, Boeing already has an understanding of what they designed and what they want to accomplish and what they want to build. They've already established the product that they want to complete. Now, my purpose in throwing this in is because we must let God be the architect. We cannot come in and redraw the blueprint of a relationship with him when he's drawn the blueprint of what a relationship looks like. He set forth, here's the premise of me being God and you being man. And I realize your thoughts are not mine. I think that's real friendly of him to say, your thoughts are not my thoughts. And then he goes on to say, nor are your ways my ways. So when I look at my ways, I have to come to the conclusion my ways aren't his ways. And then he puts this little post-mortem behind it. Your ways are not my ways, declares the Lord. Do you catch a little seriousness that he throws in there all of a sudden, but not enough to make me afraid and scream and holler and run at, oh no. You know, but I find it weird. We're these creatures, either we think we're really something, or we just fall on our face, oh, I'm nothing, I'm miserable, I'm worthless. Why can't we find the even place of saying, yeah, I am worthless, but Lord Jesus, would you come in me and abide with me, and now I will have a sense of worth, but not a sense of self-worth. My worth is in Jesus Christ. My worth is in my relationship with him and fellowship with him. And he goes on to say, he said, in my thoughts, my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. So he establishes that he has some engineered principles that are far beyond our understanding, far beyond our capability to grasp, that he is acting differently than we are in his ways. And if his ways are different, that means his purposes are different. So his invitation through the Spirit and through Scripture is for us to change our ways and our principles by changing our purpose. If you change your purpose, you'll change your ways. If I want to go to Dallas from here, I head south, southwest. I don't head north, northwest to get to Dallas. So if I want my way to change, I change my purpose. What's your purpose? Is your purpose in this life to live life for yourself? Is your purpose in this life to study a little scripture and get on the old assembly line and think, oh, well, I have it made in the shade and I can kind of orchestrate my life now? God is trying to get us dependent upon Him, not independent. Now, that's something us Americans, we're bad about because of our so-called Declaration of Independence. We want to also be independent and say, okay, you just give me the rules, God, and I'll determine what they mean, and I'll live by them, and I'll... God's saying, no, I want to be your God. I want you to follow me. So we have to let Him be God and us be His followers. And in that, we need to be transformed into His mind, into His heart, into His purposes, which will help us change our ways. Now, I'm heading to a certain spot with this, and hopefully I can get there. He goes on to make this statement, "For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return there without watering the earth, and they make it bear and sprout, in furnishing seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so will my word be which goes forth from my mouth. It will not return empty without accomplishing what I desire and without succeeding in the matter." So if God just got through speaking to us, telling me my ways are not His, and now He says His ways are different than mine, and He says my thoughts are higher than you, then He puts on the table this revelation. Just like you see the rain come down out of heaven, so my word can come down out of heaven. And just like the rain will produce crops that will produce seeds, He said, I want you to know my word, when it comes down from heaven, will produce in you fruitfulness, rootfulness, where you get your feet down on the ground in God, into the rock. And it will produce a harvest and cause you to make more seed. Now, I would compare that to the purposes of God. Would you? I would say that's His mindset. His mindset is my thoughts aren't His thoughts. Now He's giving me His thoughts. He's saying my thoughts are encapsulated in my word, and I'm willing to pour them out from heaven down to you. Now, if I am going to pass you a basketball and you're at the other end of the court, what's the purpose of me passing the basketball to you if I'm at this end of the court and that's our basket for our team down on the other end of the court? What's the purpose of me throwing the ball to you? So you can try to put it in a basket, right? So you can accomplish the mission of winning. You can accomplish of that. What if I threw the basketball to you and you, hey, everybody, have y'all seen what color this is? Yeah, look, come over here. Let's talk about this. Did y'all notice it's got a little hole in it and it's pumped up with air? And it's right in the middle of the game. Now, do you think that's going to do anything? It's not the purposes of the game, is it? So my point in giving us an illustration is we must become, in our mind, like Jesus, here to accomplish the will of the Father. And what's the will of the Father? He has something to throw us that we can receive, but I have to be down court, in position with my arms up, away from the enemy, in the open, so that I can catch it to receive it. He says that about His word. So are we catching His word? Are we in a position to receive it? Are we in a position that we can grab it, we can control it? Not control God, but control it by putting it within us, where we can receive the word of God. Now, I want to go on here, and He says, it will not return to me empty. God's saying that since I am low on character and low on His ways and low on my thinking process, He's saying this stuff is like jet fuel. It will fill you up, and it's not going to return to me void. He first of all declared I was void. Then He says, here's the answer to the riddle. I've got some jet fuel for you. If you'll just take my word and you'll receive it, then you will not be empty. It will not return to me. It will accomplish what I sent it to do. It will not return to me empty. It will not return to me without accomplishing what I desire and it will not return to me without succeeding in the matter for which I sent it. So God has sent us his precious written word, and he also has sent us his word through the Spirit and by the Spirit. If we will receive his word, it is like the water that comes down from heaven that will produce something within us. Because why? Because God doesn't want us to be empty. He wants us to be full. His Son was full here on earth, right? He did the fullness of his Father, and Jesus said, I only do what I see the Father doing. He's looking up, seeing in the Father. He can hear the Father. He never lost his focus of the purpose. Yeah, I want to give you another passage of Scripture in Psalms 46 and 4. There is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle, or the holy place of the dwelling places of the Most High God. There is a river whose streams will make glad the city of God. Now, are you the place where the Holy Spirit is supposed to reside? Are you the place where God the Father is supposed to come and visit? Are you a place that's supposed to be a depository of the Spirit of Jesus, the nature of him? That's what we're supposed to do, invite Jesus in, invite the Holy Spirit in. So there's a deposit of their nature, their character, their actions, their mind, their heart, their power, their presence, their directives, their will, and their purpose that's made within us. There's supposed to be that deposit that's made within us. So I think that we are that city. We find that in the book of Revelation. He begins to talk about his bride as that city that comes down out of heaven. He talks about her and the splendor of the bride, the new Jerusalem that descends out of heaven. So there's definitely an identifier of that. But he makes this statement, there are streams, there are rivers whose streams make glad the city of God. Now, I personally can look and see that I've lived in the desert most of my life before we moved up into this area. And living in the desert, I want to share some things with you about living in the desert. When I lived in the desert, I loved it. I really do. I still like the desert. There's lots and lots I like about it. And that doesn't mean that I don't like to get into a big mountain stream. And it doesn't mean that I don't like to wade off and do some fly fishing and be in a place where it's absolutely green. I do. But there's something really cool about the desert. Even though it's lacking life and luster, it's wonderful to see a sunrise and a sunset there. The vegetation is very unique, especially when you are down around the Tucson area and see all the different vegetation. You can't even walk, the vegetation so thick. You can't ride a horse, the vegetation so thick. But it's a different type of vegetation. Now, my point in talking about the desert is that when I was a kid in the fourth grade, I lived in a place called Hemet, California. And Hemet, California is, I think, right on the edge of the San Jacinto Valley, where the San Jacinto River comes down from the San Jacinto Mountains that do get snow-capped in the wintertime. This is in Southern California. Now, something about Southern California and Arizona and those places, if you can get water to the land, it's extremely fruitful. Why? Because the climate is good. There's no frost. Plants love heat. And the soil is usually really rich. My mother, she grew up in Carlsbad, New Mexico, which that area, the Pecos Valley, was so fruitful. I don't know if you know this or not, but there was a place called Seven Rivers that I think it was John Chisholm. There was actually a group of cattlemen that drove a bunch of cattle in that area because the area was so fruitful because the Pecos River in that valley. Then John Chisholm decided, well, you know what? There's plenty of pasture there. I'm going to take 100,000 head of cattle from Texas and I'm going to take them to the Pecos Valley. It sustained not only the other herds, but the 100,000 plus herd. There was a guy named Eddie and another guy named Pat Garrett. Do you know Pat Garrett? Shot Billy the Kid? Pat Garrett, after he retired, he went to Roswell, New Mexico, and he got involved in wanting to develop the Pecos Valley. And his thought process was, well, let's build some dams and let's put in some lakes. Let's store up what this river is delivering to us. It's coming from the high, Blood of Christ Mountains. I don't know if you know that or not. That's where that river gets its drainage from. There's a set of mountains called the Blood of Christ Mountains in Spanish, and the river flows from there, and it's extremely fruitful. Now, there was something special about the Carlsbad area and that valley. There's all kinds of potash mines around there, and so the soil is extremely rich. As a matter of fact, potash is really sought after because it'll cause your plants just to jump out of the ground. Potash is used in every fertilizer that there is. Now, can you imagine going to a place where the ground is saturated with potash already? It's a fertile soil. It's never been farmed, and you have water, and you have sun. I'm talking sun and more sun and more sun. It is a place. Matter of fact, that area, they named it Carlsbad after a city that was in Czechoslovakia that was noted for being a spa city of special mineral springs that people would go to for healing. All kinds of springs that were coming out of the ground at that time. Pecos River running through there, beautiful river. And they got the idea, well, let's develop this. So they put out these flyers, and there was, at one time, the newspaper there in Carlsbad, when it was being developed, recorded that the train had brought that day no less than 13 millionaires to the area. And the reason being is because they had interest in wanting to buy up the lands, to develop the lands into a fruitful valley. And they printed up newspapers all over Europe and all over America. Come to the Garden of Eden. Come to the garden. And they showed, you remember the pictures in the Bible about the people entering the promised land and the two guys coming back, and they got a stalk of grapes on a stick between two guys, and that one cluster of grapes is hanging on. They were great promoters, you know. That they did. They cut in some ditches in there, and they cut in some canals, and they put up dams and created several lakes, and did a wonderful job. Platted at the town and leveled that thing so that every yard had its own irrigation system. I remember going to my grandma's house, and she had a house that was on West Hagerman Street, which the guy that financed everything for this wonderful city, his name was Mr. Hagerman. That street was named after him. And I'd go out and play in the ditch of this crystal clear water that was just cold from the mountains flowing through. And something that they did immediately after they platted the streets and put in the irrigation system, they come in and planted 12,000 cottonwood trees along the streets. So that by the time I was a kid and getting to go to this city, I would come into this city, you'd come over the hill and see it below, and it was the lushest, greenest thing that you've ever seen. The trees were probably 100 feet tall. They draped over every street that there was. There was roses and flower beds and every manner of flower everywhere you looked. And it was utterly a garden paradise in my mind's eye of coming across the desert. No matter where I went, I had never seen any place prettier than Carlsbad, New Mexico, when I was a young lad. It has sorely changed since then, in that they didn't plan right. You know why? When they built the dams and stuff, they also included a reclamation thing. The government got involved. And so you were allotted rights, and the first rights that were allotted were for 100 years of use of the water, and then you were supposed to re-up. Well, they forgot about that, and they forgot to re-up on that contract. And meanwhile, all the water rights got sold out to other farmers and things on down the way. And when it come the 100 years, they found out, oh my goodness, we don't have any water. Now, they had water for people to drink out of glasses, but they ended up having to cut every cottonwood, and it just went back to a desert town that's kind of dusty, and it's not pretty like it was once. Now, my whole point in giving you that story, when I was a kid in the fourth grade, I lived in California, and my brother would inhabit. We'd walk across the big fields of carnations and the huge potato fields that were there. It was beautiful. And you would look up and you would see desert mountains. They were less than a mile away. We would walk over to those, and lo and behold, we looked up on top, and there was these huge flumes that were wooden flumes that were built across the top of the hills. And these hills are probably 500 to 1,000 feet tall in that area. And they're jumping. The flumes are going from one hill to the next. At one time, they carried great amounts of water to that area from the upper mountains. But those had been abandoned. They were decayed. The big farmers seemed to do all right because they could put in the big well systems and pumping systems and get on to, later on, the Colorado River was cut in through there, through an aqueduct to feed the area. But the small farmer, it seemed strange because I lived there in Hemet. On one side of the street was probably 1,000 acres of flowers and potatoes and every kind of thing. And on the other side of the street, it was kind of deserty because that was little farms that were like 5, 10 acres, maybe 20 acres at the most. And you could see at one time there was apricot orchards, there was olive orchards, there was peach orchards, there was fruit tree orchards. But all those trees and those orchards were almost dead. That's as a result of they stopped having the ability to be able to irrigate those things. Now, my whole purpose in telling you this is because for both of those projects, there were lakes that were built in the high, high mountains that captured the water. That captured it and held it until it can be appropriately used. God has many, many things for us that we're supposed to capture when he speaks to us out of his word. When he speaks to us revelationally, when he wants to teach us, he's saying, here is a composite of things that will transform you. Here's a composite of wealth that's like water from on high that will cause you to be fruitful. Something else that happened there in Carlsbad, they lost their source of power. Why? Because in losing their water rights, the river got lower and lower and lower, so it no longer flowed. And guess what sustained the town and its electricity? The river did. So they lost its source of power. And my whole point in giving you this understanding is that we are supposed to plan in our lives to come into the garden of God. We are supposed to plan in our lives to catch the truths that he sends to us and appropriate those so that they cause something to begin to take place within us and they transform us. There's supposed to be a transformation process taking place. And that transformation process does not take place if I take my Bible and sleep on it. It does not take place if I say, oh, I just want to absorb the word. It does not take place if I watch TV and reading a passage of scripture and, oh, that was great. Oh, yeah, that's really good, Lord. You know, it does not root in. That's a mixture. God doesn't give us in his word a mixture. He wants to give us the pure, real thing that is his voice, that is clear, that will produce something within us. If we will take the time to make sure that we get ourselves in the position to receive his word. See, most Christians don't have the thought process that it is my purpose to catch and receive your word, to store it until we can use it, because there are great things that God gives us that are beyond our capabilities of understanding. And we live in the Cascades now, and it's rich with snow above, and when the sun comes out and the torrents come and the river rages, it just rushes right on out to the sea and no one captured it. No one has held it back to sustain it. No one has held it back to use it at the appropriate time. Why? Because there's too much of it. I can tell you that Carlsbad project was at the time one of the largest water projects in the world. There were several lakes that were built. Matter of fact, I crossed across the north end of New Mexico. We used to frequently drive from Texas to Colorado. And there's a town that we used to absolutely call it the armpit of the world. It was called Alamogordo, New Mexico. It was just the ugliest of ugly that there is, you know. But just north of there, that city, there's a spark of fire that has come to that city. And the reason being is because someone had the vision to understand there's still miles, like 200,000 acre feet of water that's not being captured. And they decided to build a new reservoir that is huge, like 20, 30, 40 miles in diameter. They completed that reservoir. There were no residents that lived around it at the time. It was just desert. But everything, they completed that probably about 8 years ago, maybe 9 years ago. And since then, I've heard news of the transformation of that entire area as a result of all the irrigation that's being put in. There has to be a storing up. So there's things that God gives us that I can't handle right now and I might choke on. It's just like a huge flood coming down from the mountains. Oh, what do I do with this when it tells me to stop doing this? I can't handle that, and I got to let it just pass on by. Instead, if I will build and erect a dam that says, Lord, I will not let one word of yours pass me. I don't know how to understand it. I don't know yet what to do with it. But would you please give me the spiritual capacity to accept carte blanche what you said, and that you will someday effectively work within me the truth in such a way that I will learn your ways, that I can cohabitate with you. If we will make it our purpose in life to retain the truths of God, in retaining those truths of God, it's like retaining the water. There's many things I do not know what to do about in Scripture. I try to live by the Scripture that I understand. There's revelational things in there that I think some things are just beyond man's capability, and only God, it's His joy to reveal certain hidden things that are within Scripture. We can speculate all we want to, but Scripture is spiritual. And I'm sorry, but we, even those who've studied Scripture for 40, 50 years, we're still a flesh man. God is a spirit man. And so He has so much contained within His Word because it's spiritual that we can't see it from the flesh man. But if I will just store it up, then there will come a time that He'll say, you see that field down there? I want you to cut a new canal to that. Now He gives me the understanding for what I stored up because I believed His truth. The Lord, you said that. I believe it. I will do my best to abide by it. I ask you for power to retain it. Help me retain it so I don't let it pass by. These are the giant dams that we can build in life that can hold back the greatness of God until we can apply it within our life. There are many things we feel like failures when it comes to our personal mindset and our personal thought process about what we're not supposed to do and what we fail to do for God. And God. We struggle with those things internally. They're a constant agony, so to speak, that we just push out of the way and, oh, well, God is love. God is love. Well, if you just say that, you're not going to retain His Word, and you're not going to get ready to receive seed. You're not going to plant a field. You're not planning to build with God. Those men that settled the San Joaquin Valley and those men that settled the San Jacinto Valley and put in these lakes had in mind a purpose of building a place, building with farms, building and making it self-sustaining, building something that people would come from all over the world to participate in. And there were people that came from all over the world to participate in that project at Carlsbad. They intentionally borrowed money from a bank in Switzerland so that they could attract and advertise. They advertised all over Europe, wanting Europeans to come. They said, we'll sell you a lot for your house in the city for $50. You just come. We'll sell you a farm for $400. And this was back, that would be equal to somebody saying, we'll sell you a farm out here for maybe $10,000. Would you look if you were in San Francisco and saw prices? I mean, you couldn't buy a bucket of sand for that. would you not come up here? I can remember when I was a kid, we lived in California, Southern California, you'd see on the news, come to Oregon, land, $1 an acre. And there was a lot of people that came up and bought land in Oregon. We weren't advertising in Washington, but they sure were in Oregon. Now, let's go back to looking at the word for a moment and some of the things it can produce within us. Before I do go into that, I want to tell you one more story. When I was a kid, we traveled a lot back and forth from the central United States to western United States, and many times went across the Route 66 and even cut across a few times the deserts of the northern quadrants. And I came across the Hoover Dam one time, actually several times, and my mom and dad stopped, and my mom said, "Oh, Henry, let's take the boys down in it," because they had a tour, you know. And so we took a tour of that and saw what man could do back when equipment was little peanuts. The size of the dam was unbelievable. The size of the reservoir was unbelievable. That reservoir backs up for hundreds and hundreds of miles and holds millions and millions of cubic feet of water, cubic acres of water. It supplies about four states with water. There's been other dams that have been built since then because that one dam could not retain all the water that was coming out of the high places in the mountains. It couldn't contain it. So additional dams were built on down the way until finally there was an aqueduct that was put in at Los Angeles. There was an aqueduct that goes through the mountains, tunneled through, that goes to San Diego. The valleys are fertile down there. All this water that is coming in has come from the high places. And God says, my word is like that. It comes from the high places. And he gives us instructions not to store up things of this life for this life, but to store up for ourselves treasures in heaven. But then he identifies his word as the treasure. He identifies himself as the treasure. He identifies the Holy Spirit as the treasure. And if God becomes the treasure, then that which is spiritual can move into this which is tangible. We must get to the point that we know God well enough that the spiritual can become tangible. There has been, for quite a season, an incomplete truth told about the gospel that is just about the end time and where you go after your life here. The gospel was preached in this life to us here about a life that we could live here with the God. About a life that we could hear him and walk with him and be taught by him and instructed by him and be prospered by him. About a life that we could store up his word and store up relationship with him. About a life that he cares about us and cares about our prodigy. He cares about the small baby that I held in my arms when I was younger, my daughters. He cares more for them than I do. And he's made provision of interrelational functionality for them with him in this life and for me with him in this life. In that comes the provision, but in that also comes the greatest thing of all, and it's the revelation of him being a real God in our midst, of him walking with us, him teaching us. In closing, the water that comes down of the word, it is pure. It is not contaminated in Psalms 19 and 8. It is restraining. I need something to restrain me from going off into the evil things of this life. Not constraining, restraining. Constraining means it's going to tell me something I don't want to hear. Restraining says, here's the truth. Do you want it? Or do you not? His word is absolutely perfect. Something I am lacking is perfection in Psalms 19. His word is sure. Most of my thoughts are not sure. Are you sure about everything? You know, I have a conversation with people. Man, we could do this, we could do that, and I think this would work out. And I look at them and I, are you sure about this? Have you calculated it out? Have you talked with the bank about it? Have you talked with your husband about it? Have you talked with your wife about it? Have you considered the consequences? Have you considered what will take place? Have you considered the collapse of this or something else happening? Are you sure about this? Because the only sure word is when God says, do something. He says, we're not even supposed to say, well, I'm going to move to that city over there. He said, no. If God wills, you'll move there. So the things that Jesus was sure about was everything he heard the Father say, everything he looked up and saw the Father do, which indicates that have you developed through receiving enough of the Word a clear vision of God that you can be sure about your decisions in the future? Are you picking the right decisions in the future? Are you making the right decisions? That only comes if we store up His Word, which is truth, Psalms 119:42. If we're willing to endure and be effectual, it's the Word itself in Ephesians 5:26, it will act as a sanctifying work for us. It will purify us so we can have relationship with God. And all of these are like the building blocks of, if you were going to build a dam, you need some structural equipment and you need some material to build the dam with to help you keep the Word of God. So the Word itself, as it comes pouring out from the heavens, it's going to bring some light in Psalms 119 so that we can work to accomplish these things. It's going to bring fire, which will keep the enemy away. You remember the Egyptians were held at bay with the fire. And also the Israelis were led by the fire by night. It's going to be the hammer. It's going to be this. That's in Jeremiah 23:29. It's going to be the seed in Matthew 13:18. It's going to be the sword in Ephesians 16:17. It causes several things to take place. If we're willing to store up His Word, here's the purpose of it. If we'll store it up, His Word is the agency of any healing and all healing that we need in Psalms 107. His Word is the agency, if we'll store it up, to make us free, our children free, in John 8:32. His Word is what will illuminate to us where we can sense and see what God has to say and how He can direct to us in Psalms 119. His Word is the agency that will produce faith within us. Do you need your faith to rise? If you need your faith to improve so that you can have encounters with a real loving God where you can sense Him. When you pray, do you hear Him? When you pray, do you seek Him enough so you can hear Him? If you've stored up enough of His Word, He'll begin to respond to you. And now the Word itself will begin to illuminate Him within you, and He will give you wisdom in the midst of it in 2 Timothy 3:15. It'll cause your heart to rejoice. I know whenever my heart comes a little bit south, and I'm like, oh man, life just is miserable. Like, where's the Word? Get up there and check the dam. Get up there and where's the Word? Get up there and open the canals. Get up there and get busy in the Word. I'll get busy and I'll go up to the lake and fill a few lines in and catch a few fish and get all splashy in the water. And then I look back down at the desert floor down there and, Lord, I see I lack You right in that area. Would You show me how to cut a new canal to that, where I can flood it so that it will grow and prosper in You? So that if we do that field by field, there comes a time that the rejoicing will be intimate every day of our life. Jesus is recorded in the annals of history of being the most joyful man on the face of the earth. Why? Because He could see God, and He could see His Father, and He could see what was going on. He could see in the spiritual, He could see in the natural. He knew His Father was planning a good plan for us. Jesus did not ask you to die for Him. He asked you to live for Him. Jesus didn't ask you to be ashamed and full of sorrow. He asked you to become one filled with the Word and filled with the Spirit to the point that the joy of His countenance would be established within you so that you were a carrier of His presence. He's calling to you and calling to me and saying, will you build with me? Will you store up my Word? We can't store it up if we won't sit under it. We can't store it up if we don't read it. Would you bow your heart with me and pray? Lord, we humbly come to You and ask You, Lord, to show us how to store up Your Word, to cause us, enable us, put a thirst within us. Lord, we cry out. You started off in this and said if we're thirsty, we could cry out to You. We are thirsty, Lord. So would You come? Would You make this place one of those dams that would retain Your Word so that all who pass by the corridors could get a fresh drink from You? And even maybe even cut a canal to their field so that they can receive a supply of Your Word. bring the reality of your heart, your mind, your life, Lord. We declare our love, our affection, and our allegiance to you. And we state we want to be trained in your ways. So fill us with your word and your truth. In Jesus' great and powerful and precious name, I pray. Amen. Amen. Why don't we do some worship? adoration.
Teach us to worship you, Lord, like it is in heaven. That the sounds of our praise would be like the sound of praise around the throne of God. And every tribe and tongue join the song of the angels. The sound of many waters. It's the sound of worship coming from the throne. There are cries of adoration as men from every nation lift their voice to make his glory known. Sing, holy, holy, holy are to sing a love song to him. For the Lord is holy. For the Lord is worthy. For the Lord is holy. Lover of my soul.
Word, be sure to pick up some new messages if you don't have any. Be sure to listen to messages so you can grow. Listen to God the River, Lord, yourself. God the River and I are together, Father. I shared with you a story about Colin's dad because there are some things that they need to change now. They haven't lost their city, they can rebuild it. They haven't lost their irrigation system, they can rebuild it. If you once had a relationship that was deep and wide and open, it's time to restore it. It's a time to make it work. It's time to plant the trees. Cohabitate with the living God again. So we go. Okay. Just humbly come before you. I ask you to bless us, your people. I ask you to touch our minds and hearts and cause us to be mindful of you. Stir us up, O Lord. Stir us up that we would pursue you. For life is not worth living without your blessing. Stir us up with great passion that we would chase after you and long for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.